Robert Hansen, also known as RSnake, is an American computer hacker, executive, and entrepreneur. He was the founder and CEO of Sec Theory and was the co-founder of Bit Discovery, after which he became the deputy CTO of Tenable after Bit Discovery was acquired. He has previously worked at eBay, White Hat Security, which is now Synopsys, and then Realtor.com, Move.com, Cable and Wireless Pick America, ValueClick, and Silicon Alchemy. He founded the ha.ckers.org, hackers.org web application security lab, and RSnake is most well known for his security research and disclosures such as Slurries, Clickjacking, Fierce DNS Enumeration Tool, XSS Filter Evasion, DNS Rebinding, Content Security Policy, and Python NAN Injection. And as you prepare to delve into our conversation about his journey as a hacker, as a founder, as an entrepreneur, here's an exciting twist. First, let us tickle Robert's brain first. And Robert, get ready for a rapid fire round of random words.
I'm ready. Throw it at me.
Let's get started. So my first word for you is curiosity.
Wisdom.
Invention.
The future.
Future.
uncertain.
Book.
Well, I'm writing a book called AI's Best Friend. So AI's Best Friend.
Oh, wow. I would look forward to that. And then movie.
Heat.
Security.
Insecurity.
Universe.
Vast.
Leadership.
Virtue.
Role model.
Seneca.
Okay. And the last one is success.
Difficult.
Amazing rapid fire round. And let me welcome the audience before I welcome you. So folks, welcome to the Guiding Voice podcast series where we embark on transformative conversations for a better future. I'm your host, Naveen Samala, dedicated to making the world a better place through valuable discussions that add value not only to your life, but also to your career. And thank you so much for tuning in. Robert, I prefer calling RSnake. Hearty welcome to...
Either way, you can call me whatever you want.
Hearty welcome to The Guiding Voice. Super excited to host you today on my show. How are you today?
I'm doing great. Yeah, it's early morning. It's looking like it's going to be a nice day in Austin, Texas.
Yeah. I heard it is getting sunny over there in midst of winter. Mm-hmm. So that's what I got to know. And Robert, first thing I'm curious about, why people are calling you as RSnake?
Well, it's an old hacker handle. I've had it for almost 30 years. And early days of the internet, people really didn't go by your name. You went by a handle. And people would pick, big boy or, monster or something. They have whatever. But when I was going to school, they basically said, you can't pick a weird name. You have to pick your name. It has to be your name. I'm like, well, you don't know what my middle name is. It could be Snake. so it was like Robert Snake in case anyone asked. And it just sort of stuck. And now I'm RSnake.
Got it. And now let's begin with your success mantra. So please share with our audience the top three things that have contributed to your success so far.
Well, I think grit is probably number one, just sticking to when things are seemingly impossible, when people truly do not believe something can be done and just deciding you're going to do it anyway. I was told that no one could build a metadata system of the entire internet in your database. You just can't do it. Like you can't. You'd have to have a data center to do this. And yet I did it. I built it. And so I think that's grit. I think a deep curiosity is another one. Like I really kind of want to know how things work and really, really work, not just how people say they work. So I didn't believe anybody. And so this kind of brings to me to my third point. I would say a general disrespect for status quo because I know how broken everything is. Mm-hmm. And so by virtue of knowing that the people who wrote those things or did those things were fallible human beings with all the normal fallibility of humans, I don't have any great sense of wow, that must have been amazing, the fact that they did that. It's like, no, they were sloppy, they made mistakes, and that makes me do the curiosity curious to see what mistakes they made and the grit to stick with it long enough to find those issues and stick it out, despite the fact it might be very difficult.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. I think grit is played a critical role in your career. And I also strongly believe in that. Let's move forward, Robert. So you got started hunting these pedophiles. So will you tell me about that? And before that, I would like to explain to audience what this pedophilia is all about. Pedophilia is nothing but a sexual perversion in which children are the preferred sexual object. And specifically, it is a psychiatric disorder in which an adult has sexual fantasies about or engages in sexual acts with a prepubescent child. So I think that's something a sin, in my opinion. So
yeah, not so great. So when I was very early in my security career, I watched a movie called Sleepers. And I remember my dad looking at me because he knew I was into computer security. And he said, why can't you just like hack into them and find this stuff? Is there a way to do that? And I'd never really thought about it, but yes, there was. And I did a little research and there was one other very small team that really wasn't doing anything, run by a hacker named Seven. And I decided it was time to do it the right way as opposed to the way he was doing it. So I gathered a pretty big team of people, probably about 20, 25 people in total at the biggest, about maybe 5 to 10 core team members, depending on the time we're talking about. And so me and one other guy, Chalk, founded the group. And we actually had the largest bust that I'm aware of in history at the time that we did it. Nowadays, Innocent Images Division out of the FBI, they'll bust like 100 people at a time. Yeah. Like they'll just bam, 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 right? And they think they're doing that on purpose. It's exactly 100. So you're never sure, like, was I 101? You know, was I the bad guy they didn't catch kind of thing, kind of getting in people's heads psychologically. But they take out 100 people at a time. I think our bust was like 20 or so, 30, something like that. So it wasn't anywhere near the size these guys are currently doing. But, you know, we were just a nonprofit organization, just a bunch of hackers. But yeah, I mean, we did some really good stuff. And to this day, some of the people still work on some of that stuff. Some of them are still very, very deeply involved in that.
Yeah, got it. And I think that's a great cause. That is something which people should focus on in terms of preventing those kind of acts. And
I will yeah. say, as a cautionary tale, you cannot unsee certain things. So be very, very cautious about what you expose your brain to, because you cannot unwind that, if that makes sense.
Yeah, got it. Robert, can you also tell us about the time you hacked the Pentagon?
Yeah, so I was brought in by name. They actually asked me to come in and do an analysis during a program called Hack the Pentagon. That's the program initiative they had run. Uh-huh. Run out of partially out of Defense Digital Services, but also the DoD. And they basically told me that they, you know, they asked me multiple times. I said no multiple times. They finally said, like, Robert, you kind of have to do this if you want to work with us on this other project, which was eventually what became Bit Discovery. And I said, okay, well, fine. And the way those systems work is bug bounty systems work is it's sort of a race to find the vulnerabilities. You find them as quickly as you possibly can.
No. Mm-hmm.
But I don't want to play that game. I don't care. I'm not interested in doing it. So I think it started on a Sunday night at midnight or something. And I for 3 or 4 days, 2 or 3 days or something, I think it was Wednesday midday or something, I finally bothered to log into this thing. That's how little I cared about it. And right away, I found a pretty bad issue that they did definitely need to fix. And then subsequently, using that issue, I needed to find another asset that was kind of similar to use it. That's just the way the exploit worked. And I went into my database and I found like about 100,000 assets that matched the criteria. Mm-hmm. And usually if I find 10, one of them is going to have this issue on it. So I for sure exploited it. I just didn't go the next step. So I uploaded this list of like 136,000 assets that I found that matched. And then I'm like, what am I doing? This is total waste of time. Like, so I just uploaded everything I knew about the DoD into the system, including like all kinds of vulnerabilities, like outdated Minecraft servers living on the temp fleet and printers that, you know, are publicly accessible and firewalls that aren't even made anymore and all kinds of terrible, terrible stuff. So I found a lot of bad things. And I just uploaded it all. And turns out they did not like that, because the original thing was they only wanted me to look at 21 IPs, I think it was the or something like that. And I uploaded 1.9 million targets. And with various bad things in those targets. And they really did not like the fact that I went way, 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 way out of scope to the point where they were, the general in charge of that operation was seriously considering putting me in jail. Oh. And I only found out because the chief information security officer for the Pentagon and some of his cohorts kind of backdoor, you know, stopped the general, said, you can't put RSnake in jail for hacking the Pentagon during Hack the Pentagon. It's a PR disaster. And so, you know, I found out sort of back channel that they were, you know, helped me out and kept me out of jail.
So did you expect that kind of thing happening? Like, if at all you were sent to jail, probably that would have been a disaster, right?
I think so. Well, I told them it would be like dropping a nuclear bomb on the Pentagon. Like, imagine the backlash from the hacking community for putting me in jail for hacking the Pentagon during the Hack the Pentagon.
Yeah.
And I told the head of digital services at the time, you know, sort of something like that. And I'm like, can you imagine the day you roll up in black vans and put me in jail? It'd be a disaster. And his answer, not ironically, was like, well, first of all, it would have been camo vans, not black vans. I think you're kind of missing the point, brother. So, anyway, I stayed out of jail.
Yeah. And also, it is interesting to know that you can't fly to China. So explain to our audience, why can't you fly to China?
Well, that's not true. I can fly there. I just don't know if I can fly back. So I found an issue related to the Great Firewall of China. Oh. And effectively what it would allow you to do is if you basically send malicious payloads in both directions or in one direction from a target that you wanted to block, it would effectively block them going through the Great Firewall of China. So I figured out a way to distribute this. That's the real trick, and get it in onto millions and millions and millions of machines inside China. It effectively would shut them off from the internet. So effectively using the censorship system against itself and turning off China, or a huge chunk of China anyway. And so they have two choices. They can stay offline or they can remove the censorship system. I never fully released that, but it was such a small piece of code, it fit in a tweet. You can actually distribute it out like anywhere, very, very, very portable piece of code. So that's probably number one. But number two, during a penetration test, my former business partner and I were doing, he accidentally broke into the border router. So he broke into about one third of China accidentally through one of their border routers. And so he had full access to basically shut down, you know, the bulk of China, let's say, the part of the China you care about anyway. And so I think that plus my being very outspoken about Sesame Credit has put me on a bit of a list. So probably shouldn't fly there.
Got it. Now let's talk about banks, like how vulnerable are banks? And I heard you have broken into a lot of them.
Yeah. I've broken into the back ends of 2,100 banks now.
Wow.
What a lot of people don't understand is banks use common backend infrastructure, or a lot of them, not all of them. Some of the biggest banks, they have their own independent. But a lot of the smaller regional banks, they're all kind of using the same backend infrastructure. And so, I've broken into several of them. And it doesn't take many to rack up those numbers, because, you know, if you have, let's say, 1,000 of them all using one infrastructure, you've just broken into the back end of 1,000. So I've broken into the back end of 2,100, just to give you some idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I've also broken into financial systems that are used for clearing credit cards between massive banks. So, you know, and the end of that one compromise, I had access to move around about $1.5 trillion.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of ease, I don't think it's easy, but I don't think it, for a guy like me, it's that difficult either. Because if you know where the choke points are and you know what you're thinking, if you know how banks actually work, not just, you know, you swiping your debit card bank. I mean, the actual back end, like I've been researching how banks worked for 20 something years, almost 30 years. In fact, one of the very first white papers I wrote in my early 20s, or maybe I wasn't even 20 yet. I don't know what I was, pretty young guy, was how on like X10 networks worked and ACH and routing. And back then their SSH didn't really, or sorry, SSL TLS didn't exist. So it was like set protocols. And if you really understand how banks are communicating and thinking, there are singular places that you can attack and do a lot of damage. And then also a lot of the banks, they don't really do a great job of hiring for people to break in. They hire for compliance. Mm-hmm. They want to make sure that they pass compliance. They don't really care about finding that weird esoteric way to get in. And as a result, when I get brought in kind of by accident, because they kind of don't know who I am, I find the thing that no one is supposed to find. And it's all, you know, all hands on deck to get it fixed once I find it. So I wouldn't say it's terribly difficult. I've never not broken in to a financial when I've tried. And I've been doing it for, you know, on and off for, you know, almost 30 years. So I wouldn't put them at the most secure thing I could possibly imagine. But because a lot of people care about the financial institutions, they tend to be more secure than, let's say, retailers, and far more secure than things like water and power systems, or, you know, the SCADA systems that run all of the infrastructure that we rely on.
Yeah, got it. So far we have been talking about breaking the system. Now let's talk about what have you built that you are the most proud of?
The thing that I am most proud of is something called content security policy. It was something I developed back when I was at eBay, and I shopped it around to a bunch of different companies. Mozilla are the ones who picked it up. They realized that it was a really good idea. It took them several years of thinking about it before they finally pulled the trigger. But when they did, effectively, it allowed the companies to say, if you trust me enough to do what I tell you to do, trust me enough to tell you not to trust me. Like turn off controls and, you know, make things more secure in the browser if you hit these web pages. Like, don't render third-party JavaScript. Don't allow people to embed me in websites. Don't do this, don't do that. Yeah. When that was released, effectively every single browser on earth, including in your phone, everywhere, now has this thing embedded in it. And so because of that hard work I did all those years ago, now 1 billion people are more secure because of the work I did, which is, I'm really proud of that.
Brilliant. So when we talk about the cybersecurity challenges, right, they evolve almost on day-to-day basis. And what I personally feel is hackers are smarter than developers. And they try to break into systems by finding the loopholes or finding something or the other. So when we talk about the most pressing cybersecurity challenges facing individuals and organizations today, how are they evolving in future also? Like, what are the most pressing challenges, and also how do you see them evolving in the future?
Well, this may not be what you're expecting me to say, but this is actually the answer. It's not finding the next vulnerability. That actually isn't the problem.
Okay.
The problem is we don't know how to value what you found when you find a vulnerability. I don't know how important that vulnerability is. And if you look at the adults in the room are the insurance industry. They know where the breach loss is, not just that the breach happened, but there was actually loss associated with the breach. And if you remove, you know, the non-financials of the world, like the SCADA systems and the military, and you just focus on retail and large businesses or whatever, it's pretty obvious that there's not very many vulnerabilities that actually matter. There's about around 60-ish vulnerabilities that actually lead to breach loss and nothing else than that. And yet, if you look at existing systems that find vulnerabilities, they find around 10 to 20,000 vulnerability types. So that's just a lot of busy work. That's just wasting people's time. So the real question is, how do we value the real likelihood of breach and what happens if that bad thing occurs? And then if you model that against the cost of remediation, you should be able to tell which vulnerabilities you should fix in which order. But what's happened is people have what's called stoplight security, where everything is high, medium, and low. Well, if you have a high on one and you have a medium on another, it sounds like you should fix the high. But if the high is sitting in an environment where there's nothing, it has access to nothing and there's no data on it or whatever, why is that high? It should be a nothing, right? Whereas the medium might be the crown jewels. It might be the nuclear codes. It might be something very, very important, right? Well, clearly that has a way higher both risk, because that's where everyone's trying to attack, assuming it's publicly accessible, let's say, and damage potential if the bad thing happens. So it's not a medium. It's the highest high that's ever existed. And so that high, medium, and low thing, stoplight information security, is the thing that needs most to change. And I think at least some people are now realizing that they need to move in that direction.
Robert, let's also talk about the most challenging ethical dilemma you have faced in your career as a hacker, and how did you resolve it?
Yeah, I was actually just talking with somebody last night about this exact topic. I think it was early days when I had to decide whether I was going to go what's called full disclosure or quietly disclose the vulnerabilities that I find. And it certainly was ethical, and I'm not sure I chose the right thing. But what I did choose is, if the companies appear to be willing to work with me and are making a concerted effort to do the right thing, I will tell them.
Yeah.
If I don't know who they are and I know nothing about them, or if I have any inclination that they are not willing to fix their vulnerabilities or not taking things seriously, then I will just go full disclosure. I think it was ultimately the right choice. I'm not 100% sure, but I'm pretty sure it was the right choice, because what it did is it raised awareness. Like, I've got about 1,000 different companies all over the world suddenly realizing web application security was something they need to pay attention to. I realized, yes, that means, yes, I did hack into over 1,000 different companies in some degree or, you know, in some way or another. But I ultimately think it was the right call, because what it did is it finally made it front and center and not a make-believe thing that hackers could do a thing. It's like, no, this one hacker is doing it. Yeah. And he's making it very public, and all these other hackers are watching. And now we have to be better. And I think if I hadn't done that, it probably would have taken years before people took it seriously. Ultimately, I think it was a really good, ultimately, it was long term, not in the short term. Short term, it was a nightmare, but long term, I think it was worth doing.
Wonderful. So this has been fabulous conversation, and personally, I learned a lot about you and about cybersecurity aspects. And now it's time for us to add some more spice and some more excitement to the episode. If you are ready, let's do the second rapid-fire round.
Sure, let's do it.
Okay. So here comes the first bullet. If you could have one gigantic billboard anywhere with anything on it, what would it say?
I always thought it would be funny to have a billboard that says just Robert's back with a picture of me. Absolutely no context whatsoever, no webs, no URL, no QR code, because then everybody would be like, who's Robert and where is he backed from?
Love it. Interesting. Okay. And if you could have a superpower related to cybersecurity, what would it be, and how would you use it?
I would probably like the ability to immediately and perfectly vet any security claim. Mm-hmm. Because then I would be able to make better bets on which security products people should be buying, building, using, etc.
Mm. Wow, nice. And can you describe yourself in just one word?
Complicated.
What is the biggest...
If I had to choose another word, I would choose dangerous.
Please go ahead. Okay. And what is the biggest misconception people have about hackers, and how would you debunk it in just one sentence?
I think that most people think hackers have a certain aesthetic. They look a certain way, and they absolutely do not. They look like all kinds of random things. You would never know a hacker sitting next to you. A lot of them are just normal looking human beings.
Oh, good one. And if you could swap your life with someone for a day, who would it be and why?
Probably Xi Jinping, because I would like to know what kind of person is okay killing millions of people, and how you justify the actions of a genocide for a greater good.
Good one. And here comes the last bullet. What is one electronic gadget or a fantasy gadget that you'd like to see or invent yourself?
A buddy of mine created a project called Project Evil, which has a terrible name, but it's actually a very cool idea. It's a mix of a bunch of radios, different types of radios. It has Bluetooth sniffing and Wi-Fi sniffing and RFID sniffing and all different types of radio spectrums. And it combines it all, logs it all, plots it all. And so, and it has cameras and stuff. And so that you can tell who has traveled by the house, or if you can put it in your, put it in the back of a vehicle or whatever and see if people are following you. You could use it to see if you have like helicopters like circling over your house a lot. He really designed it to be more for like drug dealers or whatever. But I think it has a lot of utility just for people who care about their personal safety. You know, there's a lot of really crazy people out there. So I think that's a product that should exist. I think it'd have a lot of utility.
Yeah, agreed. And that's an interesting product to have. And thank you for participating in the second Rapid Fire round as well. And let's be back to the mainstream. And now talk to us about your podcast, the RSnake Show. And I'm more interested to learn about the best and worst experience that you have had in 2 years, right? Little over 2 years that you have
had
your podcast.
Yeah. So I started the RSnake Show about, as you said, maybe a year and a half or so ago, wherever it's been. We're in our eighth season. It's a bit of a hard show to explain. It's really just what interests me.
Okay.
And what interests me can vary a lot. You know, sometimes I'm talking about whiskey or something. Sometimes I'm talking about some social issue, but sometimes I'm talking about very, very deep technology stuff that, you know, it's very hard to follow. You know, it's not meant for the average person to understand or be able to fully digest, like deep AI stuff, deep graph theory stuff, deep technology around security, whatever. Hypersonic vehicles, you know, very deep in the weeds type stuff. But if you're willing to hang with it, I think it's very interesting to hear these people talk about things that are typically inaccessible to the average person. They never get to see these things. They never get to talk to these people. I had the governor of Missouri on the podcast, I think it was last week or so. And today, Greg Hurwitz, who's one of Jordan Peterson's best friends, was on talking about his book and, you know, a bunch of aesthetic issues around like philosophy around, you know, how education works. It's a very broad, complicated thing. It doesn't have a simple, we can't just say it's this thing. I don't have a pin on it.
Okay.
But I'd say the best probably early on thing was I finally got the CISO of the Pentagon to say on camera about the Hack the Pentagon story. We finally got him to talk about it. Because I think me saying that these things happened, it sounds a little like I'm making stuff up. Mm-hmm. So gradually over the years, I've gotten more and more people to show up on the podcast and tell their version of the same story I tell. Oh, and so now it's been documented, you know, hacking in one third of China. I had James Flom, rest in peace, on the podcast talking about that and, you know, having carnivore boxes in the network, you know, because we were heavily monitored by the government and, you know, all kinds of crazy stories that sound make-believe until you hear someone else talking about it. And yeah, this is a real thing that occurred. So I'd say that's probably the best, is being able to document these things that are nearly impossible to document in any other way. And then I'd say the worst was two of the guys actually on the podcast were in Trump's White House during or a week before the January 6th riots or attacks or whatever happened. And it's not so much that it was bad that they're on the podcast, but I somehow got reviled as I was somehow involved in it. I'm like, how do you get the mental leap that I know people who were involved and I was involved? That doesn't make sense. But the podcast has been used as evidence during the January 6th commission's report. And that caused a bit more drama than I was expecting. But ultimately, I think the podcast has been useful. It's gotten a lot of people's voices out there. People you'd never normally talk to, people who never go on camera ever, people who don't have social media even. So there's no way to run into these people. So I think that's my answer.
Great. Thanks for letting me know. And for those of you who are listening or watching this episode, you will find the link to RSnake show in the podcast, the show notes or the episode description. And thank you so much, Robert. I really enjoyed the conversation. And how is your experience being hosted on the Guiding Voice podcast? Have you been to any Indian international podcast or Indian global podcast before?
I have probably been interviewed by about 1,000 people now. Yes, for sure. For sure. 1,000 people. And I've probably presented in also probably hundreds of places anyway. Yeah. So for sure. But like, I always enjoy just a fun, conversation. So for me, this is great. And if your listeners have any questions or whatever, they can feel free to reach out and ask me directly.
Yeah, absolutely. So your LinkedIn profile will anyways be linked. And for those of you who want to connect or follow Robert, so feel free to do so. And Robert, thank you once again for accepting my invite and joining as a guest on The Guiding Voice. Looking forward to many more conversations in future. I really appreciate you taking time for this.
Thank you, Naveen.
All right. So friends, that was our episode with Robert Henson. And before we jump into the fun trivia section, we have a quick request. In case if you haven't already subscribed to The Guiding Voice podcast, request you to subscribe, because subscribing keeps you updated on new episodes. And also, if you have enjoyed the conversation and found it useful, please share with at least 3 of your friends or colleagues who would also like The Guiding Voice, and so that you can also spread the knowledge and help others grow just like you. Now, let's get into the trivia segment, and today's trivia is about the history of hacking. After going through Robert Henson's profile, even I got curious about hackers and hacking, and I thought, let me delve into the history, and I'm going to present you a few facts related to the history of hacking. And it traces back to the late 1950s and early 1960s with the emergence of computer enthusiasts exploring system capabilities. Originally, a term for skillful programming, which is like hacking, is evolved by the 1970s to denote unauthorized computer access. However, high-profile incidents like the 1988 Morris Swarm highlighted hacking as a security threat. And over the decades, hacking grew in sophistication, with hackers exploiting system vulnerabilities for various motives, including financial gain, activism, and also espionage. And the internet era has expanded hacking's reach as well as complexity, leading to the formation of hacker groups and a global community sharing techniques as well as tools. And despite its often negative connotations, hacking has also positively influenced cybersecurity through ethical hacking and also vulnerability research, and balancing between technological advancement, security challenges, and the diverse motives of the hacking community. So this is all I wanted to share about hacking. However, if you have any interesting facts related to hacking, feel free to drop so in the form of comments if you're watching this on YouTube, or if you have found this on audio platform or some social media platform, feel free to leave your comment there. I would be happy to review them. And that's it for today. So folks, thank you so much for tuning in and also for being part of awesome TGV community. We'd love to hear from you. So do not hesitate to share your ideas, feedback, topic recommendations, and also guest speaker suggestions, either through social media, or you can also email us at theguidingvoiceforyou@gmail.com, and let's create content that resonates with you. I'm your host, Naveen Samala, a lifelong learner. And my goal is to have impactful conversations that improve not only your life, but also your career. So until next time, take care, stay inspired, and remember, the future holds great things because the best is yet to come. Goodbye for now. See you on the next episode with another amazing guest. Take care.